And so here it is, the first time the outside of my rickety little shed has ever been on a video. And it's not much to look at, to be honest. It's falling down, it's got a bowed roof. Most of it's rotten on the outside, but you're going to be amazed by what we've managed to fit in on the inside in order to make these videos. So let's have a look inside. Come on. It dawned on me a couple of months ago that actually people would be interested in seeing the space that I make my videos in. It's just a rickety old shed, 10 foot length, 8 foot width. It is tiny. Let's just add to that, no electricity, so no power of any kind down here. But I do manage to do a fair amount in here. But I give you fair warning, the end of this video is fairly bittersweet. So stick around for that. So let's start the tour. What you're going to notice as we go around is one of the biggest difficulties that I have to overcome, and that is lighting. You're going to see in places that I would never normally film in and normally show you. And the reason I don't normally film in them is either there's nothing interesting to see, or there's something I want to hide from you, or like mess, nothing untoward. Or it's just not a place that I can get any level of good picture quality that is worth showing you guys. So you'll notice as we go around some of the pictures, the quality does deteriorate while we're there. I can only apologize for that. I just can't get enough light into that area to show it to you. The main reason for me showing you this is not to show off the space or the tools or anything else like that. It is just to show you that no matter what your limitations, space, tools, ability, things like this, you can overcome them, and hopefully it'll inspire a few people to do exactly what it says on the tin and start making. So there's no better place to start than right here. And without me even moving, the first thing you can see is why I've set this back wall up the way I have. Everything I need is within almost an arm's reach of where I stand slash sit to talk to you guys. So let's start right here in this corner. I use a French cleat system, and there's a couple of reasons I use it. Firstly, flexibility. I can move things around as I change my mind on things. All it is a case of lifting them off, moving them to a different location, and swapping them around with whatever was there. So I can make sure that all of the most useful things I have are right there within reach. If anything right next to you gets too dusty, you probably don't use it enough, and maybe it's time to move it further down the cleat wall away from where you are. But there's a second reason. The other one is that some of the French cleats that I've made, I can actually take the entire shelf off, such as my glue shelf, take it over to my workbench and place it down, and then I can use everything that's in it, put it back in there, and move it away. I try and be really regimented about the clear up at the end of the day, and with everything within one arm's reach, I can at least clear my main workbench within a few minutes and get it ready to go for the next video. This is clamps, and there are clamps and there are clamps. I am not the YouTuber that I was at the start who would say to you, you just need as many clamps as you can get. You need the right type of clamps. So if you're starting out on your journey right now and you're watching this as your first video, choose carefully what your first clamps are going to be. What are you going to be making? For instance, the clamps on this wall, if you're going to be doing large board glue-ups, you're going to need something like this. This is a sash clamp. With this, you can lie your boards on it, glue them together, clamp them up, and you can make fairly large panels. If you need to go bigger, you can get pipe clamps. All the rest of the clamps are relatively smaller in comparison. These are my squeezy clamps. They are small, they are light, and they are just for doing quick hold togethers. Something like if I'm putting a small piece of veneer on, or I'm fixing a tear out, or if I'm just holding two pieces together that are quite thin, these are perfect for that because they're quick to use and they're quick to take off again. With speed being of the essence, then I would move to these. These are just squeezy clamps. If I want to do things like hold a piece of work down to my workbench while I give it a quick sand, this is the quickest and easiest way that I've found to do it. But if you want some extra pressure, that's when you move on to an F-style clamp, because with the twist motion, you get less slip and you can put more pressure on it. As far as clamps go, if you are starting out and you're looking for the jack of all trades of clamps, this is perfect. I wouldn't go any smaller than this because it works well for small to medium sized projects, but it can be relied upon. It is effective. It's not all that expensive. There's the avoid ones. I can fix these, but they are cheap and they will slip. These are larger F-style clamps with a longer mouth. So if you need to get the clamp action further across a piece of wood, these are perfect. I've only got two, but you only need a couple because it's rarely you need to use them, but when you do, you'll be glad you've got them. And then there's just a few of the slightly longer F-clamps with the squeezy grips that I've got here. They're very good quality. The drill station is a bit of a tricky one because I don't believe there's a one-size-fits-all drill station. I use one drill and one impact driver. That's two. I use one drill and one impact driver. And unfortunately, they're both on different battery platforms because the drill just won't die. But I just built one that will fit them both in. And it's got a shelf on the top to put, well, anything that ends up on there. It's the sander at the moment. I'm going to make my tool holders more modular like that, and then I'll build another one if I get any other drills or drivers. But the main thing to note with this is with that French cleat system, it's really easy to do, and it's really easy to add to it. Mind. I think now's a really good time to just touch upon that and just say that everything that I've done to this workshop, about 90% of it I've catalogued. I started off with a rickety shell of a shed. I've insulated it and I've clad it to get it as warm and as soundproof as I possibly can, and from that moment onwards, from the finishing of the cladding, I've filmed everything else. So if you're looking for something that you see within this shop tour, whether it's the French cleat system, whether it's the holders that go on it, whether it's the handy sign that I made, whether it's any of those things, they're all in the video. If there's any questions on any of it, how it's been made, anything that's not clear in those videos, reach out, drop me an email. Now, let's work across the back. I've got these trend router bits that I got. I've taken the internals out of the box that I got them in and I've put it into a wooden frame with a French cleat on it. This way I can see what each bit does and I can read the dimensions. I don't lose any of that information, but it looks a lot nicer than keeping them in the plastic box, in my opinion. Anybody who's got hand planes, if you're not displaying them, you don't love them enough. I'm kidding. These were my original four. You've got the low angle block plane, which is the very first plane that I think you should get. And then quickly behind, you've got the vintage number fours and your block plane. But start with a new modern jack plane. The Stanley Sweetheart's a really good way to go and you'll build your confidence. Moving from there, things always accumulate on the top, such as the plow planes that I've got no idea how to use properly and the rebate planes. And then across this shelf, which incidentally was built to be the same height as my workbench so that I could put pieces of wood across the two if a project got too big for this table, but seems to have become a display for my overflow of hand planes. One tactic that I use that I think is worth pointing out at this stage, you'll have noticed that there are actually some yellow labels or yellow tape stuck on my hand planes. That's because I've got at least two of many of the planes. So I like to do my sharpening all at once. So I'll mark up the ones that are dulled with a bit of yellow tape. And then when I've got four or five that need doing, I can just sit down, put some music on and sharpen all of them. I also find that repetition gets better results. So doing them all at once actually gets better results through practice. And then moving across from there, we've got the French cleat sanding disc holder. Make one of these. It doesn't matter how nice you make it, just split them up and then you'll also see when things start to run out. Really handy. Up here, scrapers. Across here, right over to the back corner, I've just got two of these big magnet strips. And these, if you're trying to get your smaller tools off a workbench, grab a couple of these magnet strips because the tools snap on and snap off beautifully. It just keeps everything really tidy and you can grab them and put them back in seconds. I have separated mine into files and chisels just to try and keep some sort of an order. I've used the really small strips just to put my drill bits, the ones that I use all the time. These, and then next to it, Forstner bits, just because they don't fit very well in a drawer. Managed to get my big bald head in here. It's my squares, it's my marking knives, it's everything that I need to mark out my work. And then behind it, I've got my Japanese pull saws. Oh yeah, and spoke shaves, and another one of the small bit bars up the top there. So that's everything behind me, apart from what you don't see. So under the counter, I've got my KREG jig. And that sits on a French cleat shelf. And I've got a series of saws, but they all sit on pegs. And all that is a French cleat with a dowel in it. I'm not gonna lift it up, but I've got my portable workbench against the wall. And then right in this bottom corner, I came up with a little bit of an idea. I thought about these removable boxes on French cleats. So then what I could do is make a series of these really roughly thrown together boxes. I've put a French cleat on two sides of them. So you can just hook them back into the wall. And also, because you don't have to have the support going further down to stop the tipping, you can fit more on top of each other. And what I found with these boxes, much the same as the drawers that I made that go in the shelf at the back, if you can pull them out, pop them on your workbench, use whatever's inside them, and then throw them back into the place that they started off again, all of a sudden, you're making your life a lot easier for keeping your space tidy. I got one for all of my different tape measures, got one for batteries, and then the bottom one, because it won't get in the way of getting in the other ones, is a wider box, same design, and I just chuck all of my different grit sanding pads in here. Quick tip, and you don't have to take me up on it, buy enough of these so you got one per grit. Write the grit on it and never change what grit you put on it. So you don't have to keep ripping the pads off and changing them around. Little changes can make big, big differences. When it's not in its secondary location, this blue bit you can see in the corner, my removable bin, gets in the way of every single shot I ever do because I forget to move it. And the blue bag really stands out. Stick around and I'll show you where it moves to and why it's such a useful addition. This is the first thing that I ever built for my workshop. And actually, scratch that. That's not the first thing I ever built for the workshop. This is the first thing I ever built for the workshop. Because frankly, if you haven't got a workshop and you need to be doing woodworking, two sawhorses and a piece of plywood is a perfectly good workbench to get started on. Then I built this. It is basically outdoor timber, thick because it was available, a piece of plywood on top of some old climbing frame legs, relatively flat, and it does a good job. And underneath is where I hide some more things that I don't want you guys to see every day on every video. Let me show you. Underneath this workbench are all of these stacking boxes, and I find these really handy for tools, for bits and bobs, for all of your hardware, things like that. On the other side, this is where my KREG crosscut station lives. That is so handy. That needs to be accessible at all times. It's Japanese pull saw crosscut station. And then I made these really cheap pine boxes for all the things that don't fit into drawers and don't store easily. Oh, and while we're down here, this is the side of the workbench that you see me working off. One French cleat, and what that means is I can stick my bin on it, like that. It's up level with the workbench so I can sweep stuff into it. And look, down here, I've got my brushes for it. Pretty good for workflow. I don't know who inspired me for this, but this is for carrying sheet goods. Sheet goods sticks in there, hold it with a straight arm, and you can carry easily a sheet of plywood without any problems. This is one of those super hard angles to get into in this workshop, and it is one of the main reasons I don't use the workbench. I've got my Moxon vise, the very first thing that I ever built. Register it with the edge of the workbench and then I can clamp it down. It's ready to go. Great, that's flexibility for you. Then I've got my dust extraction outside.
So what I've done is I've taken the dust extractor and the cyclone dust collector here and just put it outside. And all I do is run the 32mm hose the back of this box and straight into the side of the shed. It's really easy, you can't hear it. And as a recommendation, I would get one of these if you haven't got power and you run an extension lead, because then you can have the remote control inside the shed to switch it on and off.
And this is the port for it. That's all it is. You literally just have to plug your hose into it, you switch it on, and then you can just use dust extraction on any of the tools. Hidden away on a hook on my fancy French cleat wall is this. This is just a remote control plug. I can plug it in and I can switch it on and off as and when I need to use it, so it doesn't have to be running the whole time. And then in the corner here, we've got the router table stored. This is for my trim router, so it's only good for smaller jobs with the quarter inch Makita trim router in there. I've been watching a lot of people recently that have made tables, and I see them online selling for £200-300. And I genuinely think that this is sturdier and has more features on it. Got the adjustable fence so you can close it off around the bit. It's got the fence moving back and it's got double dust extraction. One top, one bottom onto the actual router itself. Storage inbuilt and a track on the front for miter gauge. You could also put feather boards on there. You can actually clamp it onto the workbench itself. Couple more power tools on French cleats and some more magnet boards on the back. These are for things that I will use on my way outside with the circular saw. So there's the clamps to hold the straight edge that I use on plywood. And now here we are opposite the workbench itself. So behind me, everyone's got one. You've got your bigger scrap wood bin. Mine's just sticking up out of these two boxes.
I'd love to have a better system, maybe have some more racks in this corner where I can actually fit it in nicely, but for now, it does a job. This is what I want to show you. This is super cheap, super easy, and it is absolutely chock full. No space is wasted. It is chock full of tools and bits and bobs. There's a build video. To go over it very quickly and very briefly, you've got a top where you can store stuff. You've got a fan. I'll talk you through that in a second, why I've got a fan in here in the spring. You've got drawers, all full, none of which are using drawer runners, so there's no space and expense that has been taken up through that. You can take them out. You can swap them around. My favourite bit, a sharpening tray. Take it out, and once you've finished, you don't have to find all the bits, just give it a wipe down, pick it up, and move it back into your drawers. Down on the floor, underneath these clamps, that's where our mini portable vacuum dust extractor is, with the router box underneath it, with all the accessories. I've always got a flooring tile in here because there's always an occasion where you want to put sandpaper on something perfectly flat, and then you can sand away and know that whatever you're sanding on it is going to be perfectly flat. I'm going to show you what I use to hold the cameras and mount them into the positions that I think are going to work for showing you. And that's this. It's my camera, and it's sat on one of these gripper mounts. That gets you 360 degree rotation pretty much from any point you put it on. And then what I've done is I've made these that sit into the same size as a dog hole. So I've got a dog hole there in the workbench, and I've got one there. What I can do is I can just pull the whole of the tripod out, if you like, and I can move it to any of those stationary locations. And from there, you can see what I'm filming. I've also made some additional mounts and attached them to the windowsills so that I can use different methods of getting close to the work. I can move it around. It's got full adjustability. So with all of those in place, I've got a really good chance of trying to catch what I want to show you guys when I'm making it. There are times where I encounter a huge problem that you may not have thought of that comes with not having power down here, and that is lighting. It's all right if you're a YouTuber that has a full workshop and you've got all of the specialist lights to make you look beautiful. I don't have that, and I have a bald head. So if I get too close to an extreme light, I tend to look a little bit like a ghost or a light bulb or whatever you want to call it. And that's a problem. I've tried to solve that issue, but I haven't quite got the best setup possible. And this is one of two arms that I've got with lights on them. The light is very intense. The second arm will cover both of my workbenches. It swings from one to the other. And it's probably the one I use the most, actually. Now, you can see that it's not on. It's run out of power. These are basically outdoor solar-powered security lights. You get about 2 hours of good light from them, each one, which is why I tend to use them separately. So I can stretch out the 4 hours. And they work off this. There's a solar panel. Through there and into the light. Now, the light's on, you can see that the wire is not attached, and that is because you cannot charge at the same time as being on. And this is why it only has 2 hours life, because, well, it can't do both. Now, I did promise to tell you why I had a fan in the workshop, and it's not for cooling. Very simply, turn the fan on, put it on your workbench, dust mask on, switch your extraction vac to blow, and just blow the dust right out of the shed. Once it's in the air, the fan just blows it towards the door and stops it settling on the surfaces. Happy days.
This, I mentioned at the start that the ending would be bittersweet, and that is the end of the workshop tour, and that is the end of the workshop. It is time that I started pulling the workshop down. Serve me well, I've done 40 videos, a year's worth of filming, making, editing, and meeting every single one of you that's watched these videos. You are the people that have made this year in this tiny shed with no heating and the -4 in the winter and the 29 degrees in the summer have made this everything that I've wanted it to be. Fortunately, the walls of the shed have rotted and it's not fixable. And I've decided to tear down this old shed. Every piece that I've put up and enjoyed making and working within. But I want to re-emphasize that the only reason that I could take the choice to build something in its place, something bigger, something better, hopefully with electricity, is because you guys have offered me the support and the encouragement and the advice throughout the year and helped me to choose videos with topics. I mean, the last video that we did that's got over 55,000 views was an email sent to me by Michael Wilson saying, "I think it's about time you did a new tool video." I hope when the new workshop is built, you guys will come along with me on that journey too. But for now, my name's Mark. That was the workshop tour, the first of its kind, and the last in this shed. I'll see you on the build videos. Thanks for watching.